Good afternoon, everyone. I hope there's more of you in cyberspace than there are here, because OBGYN ultrasound is very near and dear to my heart, and I know I'm aging, but it's still something that we should do. I'm Anne Kennedy. I'm a professor of radiology at the University of Utah, and I am the final speaker for the session this afternoon. We're each going to introduce ourselves. We're going to do the talks back to back and have Q&A time at the end. So our first speaker is Dr. Sugi from UCSF.
Hi, good morning, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Mark Sugi. I'm an assistant professor at UCSF, an abdominal radiologist. I'm pretty new on the faculty. It's my second year. And I'll be opening today on uterine anomalies, fertility, and just a brief bit on ectopic pregnancy. Do you guys want to introduce before or just before each speaker? Okay, perfect. All right. So let's get started. Oh, let's see, here's the mouse. I think it's on another screen. One second, there we go. Okay. All right, these are my disclosures. So let's start with a case. This is a 30-year-old female with green vaginal discharge, no prior imaging. Here's a sagittal image of her, transabdominal longitudinal image of her uterus. You can see that there's an abnormality here towards the cervix. Here's that same transabdominal view, and here's the corresponding endovaginal imaging of this patient. You can see that there's this large heterogeneous fluid collection in the region of the cervix and vagina. It looks like basically a big clot that corresponds to the finding here. Just some additional images or cinnies. Here we're looking at the endometrial cavity here, and also again seeing this big fluid collection. It looks like there's probably some retractile clot or definitely some heterogeneity of the blood products within the collection. And then on the transverse view, you can see again the collection here, but the sonographer has noted that there may be some sort of duplication, possibly some sort of uterine anomaly or Müllerian anomaly. In this case, you can see that there's probably another cervix here, so they're suspecting that there may be duplication of the cervix. On the longitudinal view of the uterus, you might appreciate that there is a split of the endometrial cavities. So here's the collection here. Here is the first cavity, and then the other cavity or horn. And then not the greatest 3D, but you can at least appreciate that there's kind of a smooth, flat external uterine contour. There is indentation of the endometrial cavity, probably by a muscular septum here and a fibrous septum deeper. So this is probably, this is most compatible with a septate uterus, although not super well demonstrated on this 3D. The sonographers at that point moved on to look at the kidneys, as they often do whenever they suspect a Müllerian anomaly. About a third of these patients will have an associated renal anomaly. So they looked in the right renal fossa, and it was empty. The left kidney was asymmetrically hypertrophied, about 13 centimeters. So this patient has a condition which has been around for some time. It has an eponym known as Herlin-Werner-Wunderlich syndrome, or obstructed hemivagina and ipsilateral renal anomaly, or OVIRA. The term anomaly has been replaced, or has replaced the word agenesis, since more often in this condition there's a dysplastic kidney rather than an true agenesis of the kidney. But it's usually associated with a uterine anomaly, such as uterus didelphis, bicornuate. It can be associated with septate uterus, as in this case, and then a dysplastic or absent kidney that's ipsilateral to the obstructed hemivagina. So one thing about Müllerian anomalies is that the abnormality associated with the renal or the urinary tract is often ipsilateral to the abnormality in the genital in the uterus, for example. So this is a nice diagram from one of our fellows from a couple years ago, Dr. Penna, who did this in Procreate, and you can see that there's a uterus didelphis here with a normal cervix, two cervices, but this obstructed hemivagina due to this oblique longitudinal septum. It turns out that this is a pretty, I wouldn't say common condition, but now that I recognize it, we've seen a handful of cases that presented de novo in the past couple years. and treatment is resection of the vaginal septum. So here's the correlative imaging on MR. This is a sagittal T2 weighted image. You can see this big fluid collection in the area of the vagina corresponding to that clot that's in the obstructed hemivagina. Here's the coronal oblique T2 image. If we catch these exams in advance, or if they're protocoled appropriately in advance for Mullerian duct anomaly protocol, we try to get these axial or coronal oblique images so that we can see the top of the uterus. You can see that the top of the uterus is smooth. There's indentation of the endometrial cavity. There's this fibrous septum. Here's that obstructed hemivagina on the right, and then the normal vagina on the left. And then again, the 3Ds in this case, and really throughout, the reason I show a lot of MR throughout this talk is because the 3Ds are really hard on ultrasound. If you've ever done a HICO-C on a retroflex patient with multiple myomas, for example, I mean, these can be really challenging. But here you can see again that sort of smooth outer contour, the two cavities in that obstructed hemivagina on the 3D. So here's a correlative case with very similar findings just to show this same kind of pattern. This was a 22-year-old G0 who presented with abnormal vaginal discharge and dyspareunia. She was treated for suspected PID several times over the past 5 years. And on this image, you can just see it's a transverse transabdominal image. It's her bladder, and then she has clearly a didelphous uterus. So that's her uterine anomaly. Again, looking up towards the renal fossa, there's an empty left renal fossa. Her right kidney looks enlarged. Endovaginal views show a fluid collection, in that area of the vagina. Here it is on the cine. Again, kind of mobile blood products throughout this collection. And just to identify the anatomy here, this is the uterine cavity here, the cervix, and then the vagina here. Again, correlative imaging on the MR, you can see this is sort of an axial oblique T2. There are the two uterine corpi, or separate bodies, which make this a uterus didelphous. And then this is just a sort of a cine or a loop through the MR. As we come down axially, you can see, if you look down towards the left, you can see that obstructed collection in the left hemivagina there. And this corresponds to what we see here. So this pattern is very common, and the reason I'm showing a few cases, and I'll show a couple cases, is just because the referrals we've received have been for Gardner duct cysts, and it's really, there's a lot of heterogeneity within the disease itself. One other thing that's really interesting about this disease process is that there's often, as I said, not true renal agenesis, but rather dysplasia of the kidney. So you can't typically see the kidney in immediate postnatal imaging, but the ureter is often present and patent, and it usually inserts ectopically into the vagina. So you won't really know to look for this if you don't know that this is a pattern of disease, but knowing that this exists, when they take these patients back to resect the vaginal septum, they can also address this at the same time, because this can lead to persistent leakage into the vagina once that longitudinal septum has been resected. You can also work up these patients with DMSA scans or renal scintigraphy to look for the dysplastic kidney. These patients can also get pregnant. Here's a 22-year-old, G1P1. She's at 29 weeks. She was referred for a Gardner duct cyst. We saw this patient. Here's her ultrasound. You can see the fetus is cephalic. There's this fluid collection down by the vagina. This is a transverse image of it, bladder here, and then this big collection with some clot in it. Here are just some additional cine images through there, so you can see this big, again, very similar to the prior cases, this big collection. In this case, it has more layering eccentric clot. And then the sonographer identified a separate cervix here, which you can see is closed. So this patient also had an MR, which shows, I think, the findings really nicely. Again, fetus is cephalic. Here's the bladder on the ultrasound, here's the bladder on the MR, and here's that fluid collection expanding the obstructed hemivagina. She went on to term, delivered at 4 weeks via C-section, was found to have a bicornuate uterus, which contained the living fetus, and went on to elective resection of the septum 6 months postpartum. I don't know why they waited 6 months, because this seems like a painful process, but they waited 6 months in this case. So Ovira is one of many different sort of constellation of anomalies associated with Mullerian duct anomalies, and I think it's kind of interesting because, as I said, if you know to look for these certain details within the within these specific set of anomalies, you can really potentially guide patient care. So let's just review some of the basic uterine anomalies. I know everyone in here knows these quite well. So these guidelines haven't been updated much since the 80s. There were some kind of minor revisions. In 2016, the ASRM updated their guideline. They had a guideline called the uterine septum. Is there an echo or is it okay? No, okay. They had a guideline called the uterine septum, and basically the three main entities that they aimed to differentiate were normal arcuate, which they combined as one, so essentially eliminating arcuate as a real quote-unquote pathology, septate uterus, and bicornuate uterus. And these are MR images, but we'll look at some ultrasounds. So as I said, this can be a pretty challenging task to acquire good 3Ds. Fortunately, as some of the newer machines have made this much easier, you can just hit the 3D button and then trace this out along the course of the endometrial cavity through the cervix, for example. You get these really pretty pictures like this. Nice normal uterus. You can see the external fundal contour, the endometrial indentation, all the way down through the cervix. So let's talk about normal and arcuate and just to look at the lines, just to remind ourselves what we're supposed to be measuring here. The first thing is depth, which is the interstitial line to the apex of the indentation. So the interstitial portion of the tubes basically coming into the top of each cornua and then down to where the endometrium will dip, in this case, pretty minimally. So there's that line, and then there's that little minimal indentation. And then the angle of endometrial indentation is pretty broad in this case, kind of an obtuse angle in this normal uterus. Here's more of an arcuate configuration. If you look at this one, we draw our lines. Again, this is defined in the same way by the ASRM guidelines, so there's no differentiation. But here is that line. There's the depth, and there's the angle, which is greater than 90 degrees. A septate uterus is defined by this cleft that goes deeper, and remember that you can have partial septate morphology, so you can have a muscular septum, you can have a fibrous septum, or you can have both a muscular and a fibrous septum. They define this as a depth of 1.5 centimeters, so down from here, and an angle less than 90, so this acute angle is what helps to really differentiate the subtle cases when you're debating between an arcuate and a septate or partial septate uterus, incidentally early IUP in this 3D. Bicornuate is defined in contrast based on the external fundal contour, so it's actually the depth of the external fundal contour, the top of the uterus, the indentation of that muscle, the myometrium itself. You can see that there's some separation of the uterine bodies in this bicornuate uterus. Again, not a perfect 3D, but we're working on this. We have relatively young sonographer group, and everyone's super motivated, and our 3Ds are getting better and better every day. So this is an exciting practice for us. Here's just a correlate on the T2. So the ASRM has a classification system. They actually just put out this kind of interesting package on their website that you can use this QR code for, but you can sort of, if you, it's basically an interactive tool that you can use to sort of decide on what type of anomaly is present. And one of the interesting ones is this combined bicornuate septate uterus. In practice, I find that a lot of the septate uteruses actually have this subtle indentation at the fundus, and then you're kind of left with, so here's an example on the right, you're left with, is this a bicornuate uterus, is it a septate uterus, when in reality it has kind of a combined morphology. And the European guidelines have a word for this, they call it bicorporeal, so like two-body, and septate, meaning that there's, you know, a septum. So again, this one's kind of similar, kind of hard to see the fundus perfectly here, but maybe a little indentation. Here's that interstitial line, there's the depth, there's the angle. So this looks kind of like at least a septate, maybe with a little indentation at the top. This was the 3D done in this case, and I just wanted to bring this case up because if you change the gain on the 3Ds, you can actually eliminate the myometrium and just leave yourself with the endometrium. So it sort of ends up looking more like a didelphus or a bicornuate uterus, even though this would be closer to septate morphology. So just a sort of a technical pitfall. Don't forget the cervix and the vagina. You can often find septa or quote-unquote duplication of the cervix. In this case, for example, this was a bicornuate uterus. This is a cine showing as we're scrolling through there, this kind of band between the cervix. Here it is on MR. What's interesting about this case in particular, this was a patient with a bicornuate uterus who was undergoing intrauterine insemination, IUI, and the septum in the patients with bicornuate uteri often do not extend to the external os. That's kind of an anecdotal finding that the REI folks have told me. And the reason that that's pertinent is because when you look on exam, you only see one external cervical os. But if they're undergoing IUI, and if we operate under the assumption that ovulation is more likely to drop the egg in the unilateral uterine body and tube, then you'd like to ideally know where you're going. And so it's a potential pitfall for IUI as well, because you only see one os, but in fact there are two separate cervices or two separate cervical canals. All right, so why do these matter? Well, the incidence of spontaneous preterm birth increases from septate to didelphis. So preterm birth is one factor. The uterine septum, this is sort of controversial as to whether or not this should be excised, certainly for purposes of fertility, possibly a little bit less controversial for patients with recurrent miscarriages. But one of the reasons that this is important is because this study by Dr. Ludwin's group showed that the differentiation for septate, just because of the differences in guidelines between the European guidelines and the American guideline or the ASRM guidelines, results in significant overdiagnosis of septate uterus using the European criteria, which they estimated would be a pretty substantial cost over 5 years. There was a recent randomized control trial looking at uterine septum resection, and this had it was a relatively small trial, but it was multi-center, was randomized in perspective. Women with septate uterus with subfertility, pregnancy loss, or preterm birth, they were randomly allocated, and within 12 months, live birth was 31% in septum resection group and 35% in expected management. So their studies, they said that they unequivocally do not reveal any improvements in reproductive outcomes. And I think that's consistent with, many of the REI surgeons in our practice as well. I was charged with the topic of ectopic pregnancy on my title, so I just have one case really, run through this kind of quickly, but I know you all have seen probably more frequently lately cesarean scar pregnancies. Not true ectopic, but this location, very classic in this cesarean scar niche. Cervical ectopics, interstitial ectopics. Here's a nice 3D. We can see we have a lot of these follow-up MRs actually for patients who've had missed cesarean scar pregnancies. We know that this is a potential precursor for a creta spectrum. But one of the more interesting challenges from my perspective is actually the idea of an angular pregnancy or an eccentric pregnancy. It's been a topic of discussion at our institution. And that's when you see a pregnancy that basically looks normal, but it's kind of high. It's eccentric, high up in the fundus. Here's an example of that. You can see that there's relatively little myometrium up in that left cornua or left fundus. It's kind of high up there, so what are you going to do? I usually recommend a short-term follow-up. They came back at 8 weeks. You can still see it's kind of high up, but it looks like it's growing in the appropriate direction. But it's fairly thin. If you look at this, it's kind of not where you, at least every day, typically see them. But not necessarily abnormal. This patient, unfortunately, had a miscarriage, but I'll show you a correlate case. Kind of similar, this one a little bit less dramatic, perhaps, in terms of its location. This one appears more central to me, but this patient went on to successful term delivery. So it's kind of an interesting topic. This has been discussed in the GYN literature, or OB literature, about refining this angular diagnosis. And this article, which was just a case series, just discussed moving, abandoning this term angular pregnancy and just sort of allowing expectant management for many of these high eccentric pregnancies that, at least anecdotally, many of them have gone on to do well. But we've also seen many come back with retained products of conception. So it's an interesting area for investigation, I think. All right, well, thanks for your time.
That was great. Thank you.
Will you just ask, does it sound echoey to people down there? It sounds echoey up here. Are you hearing okay? Okay, majority of people are okay.
Okay, so thank you everybody, good afternoon. So today's, I am talking about tumors and pseudotumors of the uterus and cervix. We'll talk about some ultrasound as well as some MR correlatives. My only royalty, I have royalties for Elsevier. So special thanks to the instructional committee as well as Margarita Rafson for her invitation. So our objectives is to identify the various physiological changes that occur within the endometrium. We'll discuss the various benign and neoplastic conditions of the endometrium on ultrasound and MR. We'll also discuss the various benign and neoplastic conditions of the myometrium. And then finally, we'll talk about the benign and malignant conditions of the cervix and on ultrasound and MR. So just a little bit of breakdown of how we're gonna sort of organize our discussion. The uterus, our main components are the fundus and the body. And then the other section is the cervix. The body is composed of the myometrium, the parametrium, and the endometrium. And the cervix is mostly composed of the internal os and the external os. Next slide. Okay, when you're measuring the endometrium, you want to measure it in the mid-sagittal plane, like in this diagram. And it's really the summation of the thickness of three endometrial layers. It's composed of the stratum compactum, stratum spongiosum, and the stratum bacillus. And measurement is usually from one oncogenic border to another across the endometrial cavity. And the measurement can vary depending on the cycle and the age of the patient. So phase, this is the earliest phase, which is between 1 to 4 days, and usually is starting to undergo a series of changes secondary to hormonal stimulation. It's very thin, we can see here. And it's very thin, it measures usually between 1 to 4 millimeters. So as we progress through the cycles, you can see that it starts to get thicker, more echogenic, and then in the late proliferative phase, you see this dark black line, and in between a very thin echogenic line here. And then when we progress to the secretory phase on 16 to 28 days, it gets much thicker. It gets up to 16 millimeters. So, and then when you finally, in the postmenopausal phase, it can get very thin and measure up to 5 millimeters. So we'll be talking about the diseases of the endometrium. We'll talk about tumors, benign tumors. And we'll also talk about malignant tumors, and then area, topic of infection, as well as retained products of conception. So our first case is a 19-year-old female, abdominal pain, cramping, a spontaneous abortion. You can see that there's thickening of the endometrium. You can see there's also areas which are very echogenic, the dirty shadowing. This is an example of endometritis. This is an ascending infection. Polymicrobial infection through the cervix and the uterus after a rupture of membrane during childbirth. This could be associated with fever and pelvic tenderness. The next one is a 34-year-old with a history of termination of pregnancy 8 days ago. You can see here that there is thickening of the endometrium, and you can also see that there is area of increased Doppler flow. And this is retained products of conception. This is incomplete uterine evacuation with retained placenta or trophoblastic tissue in the endometrium, can be seen after abortion, vaginal delivery, or C-section. Echogenic endometrial mass with low resistive high velocity can also frequently be found. This is a 36-year-old with lower abdominal pain, history of anemia, and heavy menses. You can see that it measures up to 1.5 centimeters. There's areas of increased Doppler flow. This is an example of an endometrial hyperplasia, which is abnormal proliferation of endometrial glands with increased ratio of glands to stroma, which can either be benign or neoplastic. Now, hyperplasia with atypia can progress in 25% to complex atypical hyperplasia. In postmenopausal, you can have up to 5 millimeters with bleeding as well. So what are the recommendations for management of endometrial thickness? If it's an inadequate transvaginal ultrasound, it's recommended to sonohistrography or MR. If it's a premenopausal with thickening endometrium, re-image after menstrual period, And if that persists, consider a biopsy or sonohistogram. Postmenopausal with bleeding greater than 5 millimeters, consider a biopsy. So what about this case? This is a 49-year-old, history of heavy bleeding. You can see this well-circumscribed echogenic lesion within the endometrium. And then you can see that there's minimal flow with this, in this mass. Here's another example, same similar case. You can see this well-circumscribed echogenic lesion within the endometrium, and there's very little flow within it. This is an endometrial polyp. These are hyperplastic growth of endometrial glands and stroma. Can be either sessile or pedunculated. Focal echogenic thickening or mass with a feeding vessel can be seen. And the risk of malignancy in patients less than 50 years old is about 0.5%. And it can be symptomatic in 11.8% of postmenopausal females. So I show this because this is a pitfall of a submucosal fibroid, which can be confused, but should not be confused, because it's a fibroid and can distort the endometrium. And you can see it right here. And you can still see that the endometrium is right here. So not to be confused. This is a 7-year-old with postmenopausal bleeding. You can see marked thickening of the endometrium here. You can see marked vascular flow within the mass. This is endometrial cancer. This is irregular thickening of the endometrium with bleeding. There's marked vascular flow. What it's important is that ultrasound has a very limited accuracy, between 60 to 76%. For myometrial invasion, and color Doppler flow will show you multiple feeding vessels within the lesion. So here is here is a similar MR. You can see it's slightly hypo-intense to the myometrium, and on contrast-enhanced images, you can see that it's relatively hypo-enhancing relative to the endometrium as well. So endometrial carcinoma and MR, it's hypo-intense on T2, hyper-intense on T2 with regards to enhancement. It's hypo-enhancing relative to the myometrium. Look for a hypo-enhancing tissue beyond the junctional zone to assess for the extent. And then MR is recommended to assess myometrial invasion, the depth of myometrial invasion, and cervical involvement as well. Now, moving on to the myometrium. Here are the several diseases that are expected of the myometrium. You can see there are tumors, malignant and benign tumors. You can see infection as well, adenomyosis, as well as focal adenomyosis as well. So here is a 31-year-old. You can see this partially well-circumscribed lesion. It's it's slightly isoechoic. You can see there's peripheral vascular flow surrounding it. This is a leiomyoma, and they can have varying appearances on ultrasound, and typically they can also demonstrate flow surrounding the vessel. May see also vessels with a stalk with a pedunculated fibroid. Now, the old descriptor used to be the intramural, subserosal, or submucosal, but we have also actually progressed from that. And then these are the new calcification, which is new descriptors, which is the FICO classification, which you can see here between 1 to 8. And basically, you're describing the percentage of intramural, 50%, for less than 50%. One you can see here is a submucosal. Here, these are intramural, whether it's greater than or less than 50% subserosal. And also, these are also a pedunculated fibroid. So let me show you some examples. So this is an example of a intramural, and you can see that it's not interacting or abutting the endometrium, like this one is right here. And you can also see on diffusion, you can see the blackout effect, which is dark on both on the diffusion and ADC. Here's another example. You can see that this is an intramural, but it's right abutting the endometrium here. Here's another one, categorized as number 4, and this is also a subserosal, less than 50% intramural. Here's another example. This is a pedunculated. You can see the stalk here. Here's another subserosal, which is less than 50%. So moving on to a different type of endometrial lesions. This is a ill-defined mass, and you can see there is areas of vascularity within it. And here is a CT, which you can see there's areas of necrosis and calcification. And here's another one. You can see that there's a large ill-defined mass within the myometrium. And this is a leiomyosarcoma. Now, the differences between leiomyosarcomas is that it has irregular borders, loss of the normal myometrial contour, and you can see elevated peak systolic velocity. Here's an appearance on MR, and you can see the restricted diffusion, and you can see areas which are T1 bright. So what about the differences of leiomyoma versus leiomyosarcomas on MR? Well, like I said, the diffusion, it has a blackout effect, but for leiomyosarcomas, they'll demonstrate restricted diffusion. They'll also demonstrate lymphadenopathy and sometimes peritoneal metastasis. Here's a different case. This is a 34-year-old complaining of pain and bleeding. You can see that there's this large uterus here. You can see this also, this myometrial cysts as well. And you can see these echogenic striations. And you can see that there's ill-defined appearance between the myometrium and the endometrium. This is adenomyosis. Adenomyosis is composed of two words, which is ectopic endometrial glands and stroma, and meiosis, which means muscular or hypertrophy or hyperplasia. And these are the ultrasound findings associated with each of them. And really, it's been described as the cirrhosis of the uterus. Here's an MR appearance of adenomyosis. You can see the endometrial cysts. You can see the pseudo-widening of the endometrium. There's the widening of the junctional zone right here. And you can also see that there are linear extensions of the endometrium into the myometrium. So what about the significance of the junctional zone? We keep talking about thickening of the junctional zone. This is a group that looked at patients with adenomyosis and assessing the junctional zone, and measuring this junctional zone has limited value for the diagnosis of adenomyosis. It shouldn't be used for the diagnosis of adenomyosis. Irregular appearance of the junctional zone, presence of myometrial cysts, or adenomyomas are more specific for adenomyosis. So we have all these findings that are associated with adenomyosis, but which ones are more specific? The three most specific findings are the bulky uterus, the heterogeneous myometrium, and ill-defined definition of the endometrial and the myometrial interface. So ultrasound is good for ruling in adenomyosis, but not for ruling out. Here's another one. This is a more more ill-defined. There's areas of smooth muscle within it. This is focal adenomyomatosis. And it's composed of endometrial glands, stromal cells, separated by myometrial smooth muscle. So what is the difference between focal adenomyosis and leiomyomas? Well, leiomyomas are more distinct. The echogenicities can be varied, and their locations are also varied. There can be submucosal, intramural, or subserosal. Now moving on to the cervix. This is the normal anatomy of the cervix. This is the endocervical canal. This is the external cervix, and this is the internal cervix. And here you can see that there is echogenic, and that's mucus within the cervix. Here's an example of a 24-year-old with generalized abdominal pain. You can see there's marked thickening of the cervix here. And this is cervicitis, which is inflammation of the cervix. Can be either infectious or non-infectious, can be early forms of PID, so that's something to be aware of. Here's a 34-year-old complaining of abdominal pain, and this is an endocervical polyp, which is growth from the epithelial cells of the cervix, and seen at the tip of the cervix, can be pedunculated or pear-shaped mass with the cervical canal, can be a common cause of intramenstrual vaginal bleeding, can actually protrude into the external os, and has a very low malignancy potential, between 0.2 to 1.5% of cases. Here's a 45-year-old with a slightly hypoechoic lesion in the region of the cervix. This is a cervical leiomyoma, and they occur in 10%, they occur part of 10% of all leiomyomas, can protrude into the cervical canal or vagina when they grow into the submucosal region. Can also cause maternal dystocia as well. Here's a 47-year-old with heavy vaginal bleeding. You can see that there's this large echogenic mass within the cervix here. You can see there's increased vascular flow within it. This is an example of, there's another example here. You can see this large heterogeneous mass, and there's marked increased vascular flow. And here's a correlative MRI here. You can see that there's hypoenhancement within the lesion, and you can see areas of restricted diffusion within the region of the cervix. This is cervical carcinoma. It's the third most common GYN cancer, occurs in the transformative zone where the squamous and the columnar epithelium meet. This can be very hypervascular on ultrasound as well. And on MRI, it's really demonstrates, again, enhancement less than the myometrium. And MRI is really excellent for assessing tumor size, parametral invasion, pelvic sidewall invasion, as well as lymph node metastasis. Here's something that we see very frequently. These are Nabothian cysts, and you can see they can extend deep into the cervical stroma, and they can vary in attenuation from anechoic to hypoechoic due to proteinaceous or hemorrhagic content. And they frequently do not have, or they very rarely actually have, absence of Doppler flow. Here's a case of adenoma malignum, which is a subtype of mucous adenocarcinoma. It's frequently associated with Peutz-Jeghers syndrome and mucinous tumors of the ovaries. It can be solid, it can be multicystic and multilocular cervical lesions. It can demonstrate some intralesional vascularity, and it can also be very hyperintense on T2, and frequently they don't show any restricted diffusion. So in conclusion, it's important to become familiar with tumors and pseudotumors within the uterus and cervix. It's essential to know the physiological changes. Color and spectral Doppler are helpful for the identification and characterization of benign versus malignant tumors, and MRI is very helpful for further characterization and staging. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you so much for that excellent talk, Dr. Nicola. I'm Priyanka Jha from University of California in San Francisco. Switching gears a little bit, moving out of the uterus into the ovarian territory. And I really would like to thank ARRS for giving me the opportunity to talk about adnexal masses and O-RADS classification. So in the next few minutes, we would build our vocabulary for O-RADS, for adnexal lesions, utilize the specific lexicon to allow us to use the accurate lesional descriptors. Familiarize ourselves with recent updates and guidelines, because there have been quite a few. Along with O-RADS came the update to the SRU consensus, the ACR white paper. Why do we even need so many? Let's try to figure it out. And most importantly, everyday clinical applications trying to differentiate between these benign and malignant ovarian lesions. This is the issue with incidental adnexal masses, that we see them quite frequently, and I'm sure at your usual workday, you see at least one case, whether you're doing CT, MRI, or ultrasound, and yet they're mostly benign. The problem happens because even though we know that maybe these are benign, we're just somehow not using the right words to describe these lesions, and some of them end up in the surgical blue bin. Now, this definitely affects the patients who may not be getting surgery that is absolutely necessary, and the healthcare system is affected by the increased costs. As we can see that accurate non-invasive risk stratification of adnexal masses preoperatively is absolutely essential. So this is why we need guidelines. These are the words that would commonly appear in ultrasound reports or even MRI reports, the most common notorious word being complex, the mass is complex. How is it complex? Well, if it's not complex, it is heterogeneous, it is vascular, or my favorite word in radiology, indeterminate. So essentially, these descriptors are non-specific, they've been used for both benign and malignant lesions, and they do not inform at all about the risk of malignancy with these lesions, and this is where the problem is. We have multiple systems in place. Let's just start talking about ultrasound. So SRU did its recommendations in 2010 and came up with an update in 2019. IOTA from Europe followed suit. 2010 and 2016 updates, and IOTA 5 is brewing as we speak. ACR has its papers, and 2020, the year that we'll never forget, came O-RADS. Perfect timing. We have all got the common goals. The goal is to separate the absolutely benign from absolutely malignant, decrease surgery for benign lesions, aid in detection of ovarian cancer, and improve lesion description by using standardized lexicon. So O-RADS created a standardized lexicon. We're like, yes, sure, let's start by using common words. And we associated these common words with when we say this, it is benign, but when we say something different, it is malignant. Now, a lot of people have this thought that, you know, SRU was a consensus paper. What about O-RADS? Is it just like another group of experts who wanted to do things differently, so they got together and made O-RADS? There is a key difference from prior publications. O-RADS is based on years and years and years of data from Europe, not from United States, at least not if it is from United States in the first few versions. And it used a mathematical model to now associate the imaging features and provide a numeric risk range or likelihood of malignancy. And this is where the strength of O-RADS lies, is in the huge patient database that was utilized in its creation. It did use the SRU pattern-based recognition approach, but the addition of statistical analysis really increased its strength. I'm sure everybody sitting here is absolutely able to look at and say, well, this thing looks absolutely benign. This is a follicle in a premenopausal woman, and anybody can say, wow, this patient has peritoneal implants. For sure, this is a malignant lesion. And this is why ovarian lesions get tough, because not every single ovarian lesion is classifiable into absolute baskets, and this is where O-RADS is very helpful, because in numbers, it can give us the risk of malignancy, it can provide us management strategies. Should we do further imaging? Should this patient go to gynecology or gyne-oncology? Because we know that patients have improved outcomes when the initial surgery for an ovarian malignancy is done by a gyne-oncologist rather than going to a generalist. So yes, it is important to know this information beforehand, because we as radiologists, based on our risk stratification, can make a real difference in patients with ovarian cancer diagnosis. I'm sure some of you have gone to the website and have looked at this table. This is where the risk stratification happens, and these are the numeric risk ranges of each of the O-RADS categories, being less than 1% for O-RADS category 2, 1 to less than 10% for O-RADS 3, and 10 to less than 50% for O-RADS 4, and if it's more than 50% risk of malignancy, it's going to be an O-RADS 5 lesion. I completely acknowledge these ranges are wide, and this is where we have to deal with the overlap of imaging features between benign and malignant ovarian neoplasms. But as more and more validation studies come out, I'm certain that these ranges will narrow over a period of time. And here in the rightmost column, we can see the management recommendations. And one thing of note here is the menopausal status does not affect the management of this patient except in O-RADS 2 category. And here, O-RADS 2 gives a nod to the fact that the risk of ovarian cancer in premenopausal women is exceedingly low, and hence there is a lot of rationale in performing follow-ups rather than MRIs, as is recommended for postmenopausal women. Some key points for the lexicon. I'm not going to show you pictures of follicles in corpus luteum, but note that these are physiologic, and they're only found in premenopausal women. And if there is one of the few take-home points that we can take from this discussion is that anything that is non-physiologic, the preferred O-RADS descriptor is lesion, the term mass is not preferred. Here are what some classic benign descriptors on ultrasound look like. We have this lace-like internal reticulations. We won't have any flow in the clot material, retractile cloud, a classic appearance for a hemorrhagic cyst. We can use these descriptors, associate that this is a hemorrhagic cyst, stop there. Doppler is essential for this diagnosis. If you have, on the other hand, a lesion, which is acoustic shadowing from a hyperechoic component, or you have hyperechoic lines and dots, then we can call this a mature teratoma, O-RADS 2 lesion, next case. Note that the descriptor dots and dashes is not a part of the O-RADS lexicon. The preferred descriptor is hyperechoic lines and dots. And for endometriomas, the next common classic benign lesion, we have low-level homogeneous echoes or ground glass echoes, which is the IOTA descriptor. And again, if we have lesions which look like this, and we can use these words to describe these lesions, essentially we have diagnosed benign lesions, and they are all classified as O-RADS 2. The risk of malignancy is driven by presence of solid component. What is solid component? So by definition, if the tissue has echo texture suggestive or similar to that of the ovarian stroma, adjacent myometrium, then this represents a solid component. In O-RADS ultrasound, while presence of internal color flow will help us detect solid component, remember that it is neither mandatory to make that diagnosis, and nor is it essential, because we know that sometimes atypical teratomas may have some flow in it. To call something a solid lesion, the lesion must be at least 80% solid in its constituents, and the following are not considered solid components. Normal ovarian stroma, blood clots or mucin, or if you have septations which are less than 3 millimeter, and all the dermoid cyst components, the fat, the bone, the cartilage, while solid in its physical state, does not constitute solid or solid appearing tissue for O-RADS. So these are what the common malignancy driving solid components look like on ultrasound. We can have papillary projections which are surrounded by fluid on three sides. We can have frank solid components, as shown in this example. And we know that when women with adnexal lesions have ascites or peritoneal nodules, they have a much higher risk of malignancy. And if you have O-RADS 3 or 4 or lesions, just the presence of ascites, which extends beyond the fundus of the uterus, will upgrade the lesion to an O-RADS 5 lesion. The color score is helpful. We understand that increasing vascularity is associated with increasing risk of malignancy, but again, while it is used to discriminate the risk, it does not, absence of flow on ultrasound does not exclude malignancy, because we know that there could be technical variations in that category. So let's talk about some practical tips for everyday clinical use. I'm curious to hear how many of us have heard or used the O-RADS app in their daily practice. Great, thank you. Thank you for trying that out. If you have some time, feel free to download it. We will do some cases in the next few minutes. I really, you know, in the pandemic, there are two things that were helpful, something that made life simple and something that I could make technology do for me. And I think the O-RADS app definitely checked those two boxes. It's really a step-by-step lesion characterization, and when we do the cases, you will see that there's a header that comes on the top, and essentially you can look at that header and dictate your report, and it also provides management recommendations all in one place. Before we head into some cases, quick discussion on O-RADS MRI, which is the MRI arm of the O-RADS algorithm. And about 25% of the masses before O-RADS ultrasound came into being were found to be sonographically indeterminate. It is that middle box that we were talking about. And we found when reviewing these cases that MRI had an excellent, very high negative predictive value for malignancy and allowed for this amazing non-invasive risk stratification that we were trying to do. Similar to the O-RADS ultrasound, there is an O-RADS MRI risk stratification system as well. And the most important thing to note here is the O-RADS 5 category, where we can see that once something is O-RADS 5 on MRI, it has about 90 to more than 90% risk of malignancy. And O-RADS 3, the risk of malignancy drops down. O-RADS 4, it kind of remains problematic. Again, it's very MRI is very helpful to look for identifying benign lesions. We can see these fat-containing lesions on fat-sat images. This is a mature cystic teratoma. Endometriomas will have the classic T2 shading and intrinsic T1 hyperintensity, and these are peritoneal inclusion cysts, fluid signal structures following the peritoneal contour. And if you see these, again, you are in a definite benign category. No worry about malignancy. Now, while the presence of color flow on ultrasound was dubious, the presence of enhancement is a must for diagnosing solid components in MRI. And this is what really bumps up the specificity for MRI. It's the presence of gadolinium enhancement. Solid components can appear as nodules or these beautiful frond-like projections, papillary projections. They can present as irregular enhancing septations, or they could be a frank solid mass. And not only can we say whether there is enhancement or not, based on your practice, most of the practices in the U.S. do not perform the dynamic imaging, but using the 30 to 45 second acquisition, comparing the enhancement of the solid tissue to the myometrium. And if the enhancement of the solid component is greater than the myometrium, you have a high risk curve, you have a higher risk of malignancy. You do not need to do the curves at all. You can just use that time point from your acquisitions, which most of us get. And just like the app, there's an online calculator, oradsmricalc.com, and definitely when we are dealing with MRI cases, this is something that is really helpful. Let's look at a few cases. So this is a 49-year-old woman. She has abdominal fullness. We see that there is this mass here. It's 10 centimeters. We're looking at this again. There is some solid appearing tissue. There is no vascularity to it. Now, some of you would say, well, I wonder if it kind of looks like an endometrioma. It does sort of have the ground glass. It's not typical, though. And then what do we do about the solid appearing tissue? We tried to move the patient, put them DQ, this thing did not budge. So now we'll use a calculator, and once you go, you can say this woman is premenopausal, it's an ovarian lesion, it is not a physiologic finding, so it's going to be lesion. We'll call it cystic, unilocular, with solid component, no papillary projections, no ascites, and here we have the ORADS 4 score, which puts us is like 10 to less than 50% risk of malignancy. You can click on the picture icon, get a quick review of all the lesions that are in this category. This most looks like this example here. And then we went on to do an MR imaging. Here on MR imaging, we are evaluating the fluid signal, which is proteinaceous. The T2 is a little dark, T1 is a little bright, and we're looking for enhancement. Remember, enhancement is really important to call anything solid component. And on these post-contrast subtraction images, we note that there is no enhancement. Sorry about that. We noted that there's no enhancement, so we can say it was truly an endometrioma and an ORADS 2 lesion. So MRI helped downgrade that lesion from ORADS 4 to ORADS 2. Here is a different patient. She's also premenopausal. She has a large lesion, and for a lot of us, we'll say, well, this is a hyperechoic lesion. It has acoustic shadowing. This is a teratoma, and you're absolutely right. And we go through the app for the same feature, so we know this is premenopausal, ovarian, lesion, and we have a dermoid cyst, but it is more than 10 centimeters in size. So based on the size and absence of ascites, we classify this an O-RADS 3 lesion. Classic benign lesions, when they're more than 10 centimeters, get bumped up in the score. Reason is because we realize that ultrasound can be limited in evaluation of larger lesions. And again, we click this button here, we can look at all of these findings, and then this is going to be a classic benign lesion. Here we have some MR imaging pictures which confirmed our findings that they, on in and out of face, there is dropout, so this is indeed a lipid-containing mass, and we don't really see how big these Rokitansky nodules can be on ultrasound, but on MRI, we have the benefit of the lack of shadowing, and here we can see that they can be rather bright, they can have mild enhancement, and this is going to be, again, an O-RADS MRI 2 lesion. Here's a slightly different scenario, 42-year-old woman, palpable mass and amenorrhea, and now we have used the calculator, so I won't go through the calculator again, but we can see that this is a unilocular cystic lesion with papillary projections, so it is going to be an O-RADS 4 lesion. And the recommendation is that you could go to an ultrasound specialist or MRI, and we sent this patient to an MRI where we found that we rediscovered these papillary components, and note that for dynamic contrast enhancement, we must use at least a 3 millimeter slice thickness for O-RADS criteria. We found these solid enhancing components. Comparing the enhancement to the myometrium, we think that these nodules look quite similar to myometrial enhancement. And we gave that an O-RADS 4 lesion, came out to be a serous tumor. What about diffusion in O-RADS? So when we have used O-RADS, we have realized that diffusion doesn't really have a lot of role to play, and the reason for this is that, yes, it can help us identify solid tissue, but there are lots of mimics of restricted diffusion. For example, you can have teratomas with keratin that can restrict diffusion. You can have hemorrhage within a hemorrhagic cyst that can restrict diffusion. Infectious processes restrict diffusion. And given that there is such a high degree of overlap, and knowing that these benign things happen more frequently than malignancy in the ovaries, especially in premenopausal women, diffusion did not make its way into the O-RADS criteria, but definitely if you have tissue that has restricted diffusion as well as enhancement, then we can use that as our marker for solid tissue. What about the SRU consensus guidelines? I'm sure all of us have spent a lot of time scrolling through these pages and cutting to the right criterion for these lesions. And SRU did come up with an update in 2019. And I think there are a few strengths for the work that SRU has done, and what they have unequivocally established is that simple cysts are just that. They are simple. They have an exceedingly low risk of malignancy. So essentially, it's to implore us to say, please do not follow these simple cysts, or definitely use an O-RADS score to give them a definitely benign characterization so that people can stop following them, and eliminate follow-up of physiologic findings in premenopausal women. Also, it elevated the size thresholds, and this is where there is a certain mismatch between what O-RADS does and what SRU does, even though they both come from ACR, but let me assure you that the two committees are working in unison to come up with more coherent guidelines, and yes, we will be using these bumped up size thresholds. So as you can see, if your visualization is really good, that is a caveat that SRU adds. You need not follow up any premenopausal cysts up to 7 centimeters and postmenopausal cysts up to 5 centimeters, again, given the caveat of good visualization. This is an excerpt from the consensus guideline, which I absolutely love, and it says that a woman with an asymptomatic, isolated, simple adnexal cyst that has been well visualized has no difference in cancer risk compared to a woman without such a cyst irrespective of their menopausal status or cyst size. Essentially, they're saying in a few more, in, you know, a few more words than a few, that women are allowed to have simple cysts. That's the job of the ovaries. So what about follow-up suggestions? Most lesions can be safely reassessed at 6 to 12 months to assess internal growth. Earlier follow-up at 2 to 6 months may be performed for larger lesions or to document resolution. So what do we do? Do we go on this never-ending loop of follow-up and just keep on following these lesions up? And I think that we have some good data from SRU there, and we will see this in the next versions of O-RADS, that if a lesion has decreased in size, stop following it. No need to follow it further. If it's similar in size, then after the first initial follow-up, we can do a follow-up at 2 years to assess if it may be a slowly growing lesion. Any sooner follow-up is only going to add extra cost. It's really not going to demonstrate growth if the lesion is truly a slow-growing lesion. If you have a lesion that's increasing in size, again, especially in a postmenopausal woman, this is going to be a benign ovarian neoplasm. And now, if previously developed simple cysts have developed worrisome looking features such as solid elements, irregular septations, then these are unequivocally worrisome findings and need to be worked up. And these are some of the ultrasound features that we've already looked at. Take irregular septations, focal wall thickening, and vascular solid components added to the mix. So it's widely accepted. It has a very high sensitivity compared to IOTA, but initially it was intended for asymptomatic patients, and now we know that it is applicable in symptomatic patients as well. And I'll quickly go. I know that I'm running over time. Apologize for that. So for incidental masses detected in CT or MRI, anything that is more than 1 centimeter in size has been getting follow-up. And there has been, again, a push to align all of these guidelines. And what ACR white paper did is that it classified 3 categories. Simple appearing cyst, a cyst which does have definitive imaging characteristics such as a dermoid, and both these categories do not need any follow-up. But if it's not a simple appearing cyst, and it is not definitively to be, it cannot be definitively diagnosed on CT, then they need to get further imaging such as CT or MRI. Up to 10 centimeters, any simple appearing cysts can be let go, and we have similar size threshold. So I'm going to quickly hurry up here. And what do I do? That was the title of the talk. So I really use the O-RADS ultrasound in our practice, I think, using the template, having the reference table at the end of the report for our gynecologist has been really helpful, and it is really helpful for those indeterminate lesions. MRI is helpful for lesions which are more than just simple cysts, especially so in postmenopausal women. And I really enjoy using the O-RADS ultrasound app as well as MRI. So take-home points, simple cyst, exceedingly low risk of malignancy. Do not worry about this. Vascularized solid tissue increases the risk of malignancy. Do not let these lesions go. Know your classic benign lesions. Try to avoid using terms such as complex or heterogeneous, which don't add much value. And using O-RADS can help not only with lesion stratification, but help us give a numeric risk range of malignancy. And SRU can be helpful for follow-up recommendations, especially for simple cysts. Thank you for your attention.
Okay, we're getting to the end. And I'm going to talk about pregnancy. You take one sperm, one egg, and you make an entire human being in 13 weeks. I've got 20 minutes, so buckle up. It's going to be a bumpy ride. And it will, if I can advance my slides, please. There we go. All right, I get royalties from Elsevier, and I do research with Samsung. Neither of them have any influence on the content of the talk. And my task of the day is to review the normal and abnormal findings and the predictors of pregnancy failure. So the usual situation, and this is the one that my residents are terrified of, is you have someone with a positive pregnancy test, comes into the ER with pain and bleeding. And our job is to figure out if we have an intrauterine pregnancy, if we have an ectopic pregnancy, or if perhaps there's been a complete spontaneous abortion. However, when you think about intrauterine pregnancy, not all of them are okay. Just because it's intrauterine doesn't mean everything's peachy. Here's some terminology that we use in my institution. This paper was published in 2011, and our OB chairman asked us to use it at the time, and we've continued to do so. Ideally, you come up with a diagnosis of a definite intrauterine pregnancy or a definite ectopic pregnancy. And for that, you need to see a gestational sac that contains either a yolk sac or an embryo or both. More often than not, unfortunately, because people come in so early now, we are left with the situation where we have an intrauterine sac-like structure, but it doesn't have anything in it, or we have an extrauterine sac-like structure in a homogeneous mass, and then, of course, we've got the situation where you have a positive pregnancy test and you see nothing at all. It's a normal pelvic ultrasound, unless they happen to be pregnant now, not last week. All right, normal findings in early pregnancy. This is what I teach my residents. You're all going to go, what? You start out as a dot, you become a grain of rice, then you turn into a kidney bean, then you turn into a gummy bear, and by 13 weeks, you have built all of the organs you're ever going to have. You just have to grow them after the first trimester. What does that look like on ultrasound? Here we have our intrauterine sac-like structure. This is actually the chorionic tissue making a ring. There's nothing in it, so that's what gets called a probable IUP. Next step is you see some content in the gestational sac. So here we have a yolk sac, but no embryo. Here we have a yolk sac and a teeny, teeny little diamond ring dot embryo, but there's cardiac activity in this. So these are now definite intrauterine pregnancies, but over here we don't know if it's alive. Over here we do. And there's a difference in my head between a live pregnancy and a viable pregnancy, and we'll talk more about that later. Just 1 week after this study was obtained, you can see that you have a much bigger embryo that is filling the amnion. Here's the embryo with the yolk sac adjacent, and I've put these, you can watch this talk obviously online later if you choose, but all of these labels are here. And these are all things that we learned about in embryology at medical school. And I have to say, I hated it at medical school because it was a list of words. I couldn't understand it. I couldn't see it. But with modern ultrasound equipment, we are seeing it unfold in front of our eyes. So here is a zoomed up picture. This is your little gestational sac. That's your yolk sac and your tiny dot of an embryo. Here's a 3D of twins. And you can see you've got two little diamond rings here. Very quickly, you go from being a trilaminar embryo to a series of cylinders, and then you elongate. So your embryo now becomes a little grain of rice. Then you become a kidney bean, where you can have an identifiable sort of head end and bum end or crown rump. And that kidney bean is rappelling down its umbilical cord into the amniotic sac. Our modern equipment is so amazing that we actually can see limb buds really, really early. And look at these little limb buds here, corresponding with an actual photograph of an embryo. So it is astonishing the detail that we see. I want to show you a couple of things that you probably see and may not quite know what they are. Here's the crown rump length, here's the umbilical cord, there's the amnion, and then there's this balloon on a string. This is the yolk sac, and once the embryo actually turns from an Oreo cookie into a series of cylinders, in other words, gastrulation has occurred, the yolk sac is no longer necessary, so it's kind of tossed off into the corner of the pregnancy. The vitelline duct and the body stalk actually fuse to form the umbilical cord. But if you do 3Ds like this, you will see that that's where the cord is going into the placenta that's forming from the chorion frondosum. And this is just the vitelline duct that's hanging on to the last little bit of the yolk sac. So that's not abnormal. Another thing that you will see are what I call the cephalons. If you remember back to your embryology and your brain vesicles, you had a prosencephalon, mesencephalon, rhombencephalon. This is a transabdominal image of an 8-week embryo in a slim mom, I admit. But look, we are seeing embryology in front of our eyes. By 10 weeks, 3 days, that has come along and we're getting more internal architecture, more structure. We can see the bones of the face. And here, this is a blown up 13-week, now fetus, because you graduate at 10 weeks. That little white echo is the choroid plexus of the fourth ventricle. In here, you have the developing intracranial translucency. Out here, you have the developing fourth ventricle. Here, you have cord loops herniating into the base of the cord. So this is an extremely busy time, and there's a lot of stuff that you need to see and know. I made this slide because this is a 13-week fetus. Transabdominal imaging, again, a slim mum. There are occasionally still some of them. And you can see all of the cardiac structures and all of the outflow tracts. I don't clear them at this gestational age, but the fact of the matter is, if you look, you will see a lot of different things. Now, one thing that's really, really important in the first trimester, the key to prognosis in multiple pregnancies is chorionicity. Monochorionic twins share a placenta, and they're at risk of all the complications that come from sharing blood vessels. The time to make the diagnosis of chorionicity is in the first trimester. Zygosity is actually important, and this is a graphic of that. Dizygotic twins, it's two ova, two spermatozoa, two completely different individuals. Monozygotic twins, there's a single egg, single sperm, and then after fertilization occurs, the zygote splits, and that's where we start getting into potential trouble. Here, transabdominal, actually, you have two beautiful, thick chorionic rings. Therefore, you're going to have two placentas. You're going to have a complete set of stuff for each fetus. This is the type of twin to have if you can pick. On this one, which is a vaginal scan, there is a single chorion. There's embryo 1, embryo 2, amnion 1, amnion 2. So monochorionic, diamniotic. Over here, we have one chorion and one amnion and two embryos poking each other in the eye. They cannot get away from each other. So they are at risk of all the complications of sharing a placenta, as well as the fact that they can swim around each other and entangle their cords. And here is the worst case scenario. This is a single chorion, single amnion, two embryos, and the embryos are inseparable from each other because they're conjoined. So you can see how completely different this looks in the first trimester. And here is the corresponding set of 3D images, two chorions, one chorion with a little thin divider, one chorion, no divider, one chorion, two embryos fused together for conjoined twins. And a little bit later on, this is obviously dichorionic, two placentas, twin peak. Here's a video clip showing one chorion, embryo one, amnion one, embryo two, amnion two, so mono di. Here's mono mono, one placenta, one chorion, two embryos squished together inside that very small room for 9 months. And here are your conjoined twins. There is no separation between these embryos at all. So extremely important, anytime you see a multiple pregnancy, try and establish chorions and amnions as soon as you can. Now, what about pregnancy failure? So this published paper from the SRU in 2013 has been out. We've all been using it for the longest time. And the rules are simple. On transvaginal ultrasound, mean sac diameter greater than 25 millimeters, you have to have a living embryo. If you do not, the pregnancy has failed. Similarly, if you can see an embryo, then you measure the embryo. And if the embryo has no cardiac activity and it's greater than 7 millimeters, that is a dead embryo. Game over. The only caveat to that is if you have a scan from this week that shows a 2 millimeter embryo, with cardiac activity and the patient comes back and that cardiac activity ceases, obviously you can call that embryonic demise as well. So that's pretty straightforward. However, sometimes you have a pregnancy, sometimes it's alive, but sometimes it's not viable. And what does viable mean? To my OBGYN colleagues, viable is a baby that they would intervene for. Traditionally 24 weeks, they're actually starting to push it back. They told me last week that now viability is going to be 22 weeks, which I find terrorizing. But they consider that when the fetus can survive independent of mom, right? For the purposes of the consensus committee, viability was defined as a pregnancy is viable if it can potentially result in the birth of a live infant. Okay, so in the first trimester, viable means if you think you could potentially get a live baby out of this pregnancy. I said I know the rules for when a pregnancy has definitely failed, but what about if I see something and it doesn't meet the criteria? So what about I see a 5 millimeter embryo and there's no heartbeat? Those are sort of what I call the in-betweenies, and they are characterized as intrauterine pregnancy. So you see a sac in the uterus, you see a yolk sac or an embryo, but you haven't met the criteria to call it failed. Those are intrauterine pregnancies of uncertain viability, and you have to follow those to see what happens. What do you do if you see a sac with nothing in it? That's our probable IUP. If your patient is stable and you can wait 2 weeks and you have no live embryo at the end of 2 weeks, then that's definitely failed. Obviously, if the patient's unstable, you're going to scan them again. If you see a sac with a yolk sac, you've now gone from a probable to a definite intrauterine pregnancy, so you don't have to wait as long. And there we like to wait 11 days. After 11 days, no embryo, no heartbeat, pregnancy has failed. If you see a live embryo, you adjust the due date based on the crown rump length at that time. If you see an embryo, but it doesn't have a heartbeat, you don't have to wait so long. And on average, an embryo grows about a millimeter a week. So if you have a 2 millimeter embryo, you can say, right, 2 plus 5 is 7. If I see this lady back in 5 days and there's still no heartbeat, hopefully I can be definitive for her and tell her what the situation is. Now, I work a lot with OBGYN docs, and I like most of them, but sometimes they do things like this. They came out with this practice bulletin about early pregnancy loss and essentially eviscerated the SRU paper that was published in the New England Journal of Medicine, that it was a consensus paper with OBGYNs there at the time. And they said, oh, this is way too conservative. Everything's more conservative than the studies they cited. This is ridiculous. We're having to do too much follow-up. And then they added the point that it was important to include the patient in the diagnostic process and to individualize guidelines to patient circumstances. I have to say I had a sort of like, yeah, holier than thou, because I was at the consensus statement and I heard the OBGYNs in that group push back repeatedly about the things that radiologists had always used. And the consensus meeting was called because of the number of patients that had had a misdiagnosis of an ectopic pregnancy, were given methotrexate, only to find out they actually had an IUP. So if we really do care about patients, maybe we should think about some of the statements we make. Here are two signs. This was published in 1995. This was before many of my residents were born. That's how old this sign is. And this was a revisiting by Roy Philly in 2009. This is called the empty amnion. This is called the expanded amnion. And embryologically, we know if the amnion has ballooned away from the embryo has undergone gastrulation, it should have a beating heart tube. So the empty amnion and the expanded amnion were both published signs of failed pregnancy that the consensus committee said, nah, no, don't like it. They haven't been studied adequately. All right, so they are considered suspicious for failure, not diagnostic of. Well, lo and behold, what did our OBGYN colleagues do? They looked at some early pregnancies and they invented something called the amniotic sac sign. Not empty, not expanded, just the amniotic sac sign. And published in 2021, they agreed with all the things that we had said years ago, that if you see an amnion that's expanded, like in this case, this is the chorion, this is the amnion, that's the little embryo in it, there is no cardiac activity, that is a failed pregnancy, and they congratulated themselves greatly because if you see this sign, you can now say this is a failed pregnancy and you don't have to waste everyone's time and money doing follow-up studies. So congratulations for taking us back to 1995. Enough nastiness. I want to show you some pitfalls. The embryo is a little structure. It lives inside its amnion, inside its chorion. This thing, on the other hand, is kind of blobby, and it is in continuity with the thickened part of the chorion frondosum. You can measure this any which way you like. You are not going to get a heartbeat in it because it's not an embryo. It's something that was very imaginatively called a chorionic bump. Could have been called a lump, I suppose, but it's just a bit of chorion. It was initially described in IVF pregnancies and was associated with a high rate of pregnancy loss. But since then, we know that if you see a bump and you identify the live embryo, that it probably doesn't actually have adverse consequences, but just be aware, because I have seen this measured as an embryo many, many times. Here's another thing. The amniotic fluid is anechoic. The fluid in the extraembryonic psilomic space is proteinaceous and echogenic, but that is between the amnion and the outer edge of the chorionic sac. That is not a subchorionic hemorrhage, that is a normal finding. A subchorionic or perigestational hemorrhage is between the chorion and the decidualized endometrium. And in both of these cases, this with a bump and this with an amniotic sac sign, these were in fact failed pregnancies. So don't fall into the mistake of thinking that echogenic fluid inside your chorionic sac is abnormal. Okay, we've talked about intrauterine pregnancies. We're going to talk briefly about ectopic pregnancies. But what about the dread situation? Positive pregnancy test at home last week. 4:30 on Friday, it's a midwife patient. They're here for viability, and the scan is normal. What do I need to know? I need to know if they're pregnant now. And if they are, do I say, okay, go ahead. Do that free solo climb in Yosemite this weekend. No need to worry about your health. Well, we don't. Because pregnancies of unknown location, about, depending on which paper you read, 11 to 25% of them can finally be diagnosed with an ectopic. So in my institution, we have this thing called the Beta Book, and it is owned by the GYN residents. These women get serial quantitative beta HCGs, and if it goes up, we scan again to try and find the pregnancy. If it goes down, we assume it's failed wherever it was. And if it plateaus, we all have serious indigestion that we are, in fact, dealing with an ectopic that we have to find. So you do not send people with pregnancy of unknown location off, and good luck with that. Speaking about ectopics, it's a huge subject. I could talk for an hour on that alone, and we have touched on it briefly. Here's a nice paper which has some terms that they suggest we use, has some beautiful line diagrams, and nice 2D and 3D ultrasounds of ectopics. Obviously, tubal is by far and away the commonest, but I want to show you briefly some of the ones that are a bit scarier, and we have touched on this already. But this is an interstitial ectopic. This is in the interstitial portion of the fallopian tube, so it's surrounded by myometrium. Coronal 3D reconstructions are really helpful in this because you can see here's the endometrial cavity, and that gestational sac is in the uterus, but it's not in where it should be. It is not okay, and this is an ectopic. Similarly, a cervical ectopic is quote unquote in the uterus. And here we talk about this hourglass appearance where the myometrium around the body of the uterus is okay. Then you have a narrowing for the internal os. And then you have this bulging gestational sac, which is displacing the endocervical canal. And my slides are advancing by themselves. But anyway, that's a cervical ectopic. Cesarean scar pregnancy, we touched on it briefly. I come from Utah where we have big families and we have patients who have multiple cesarean sections. My personal record is 9, but you know, we try not to go that far. I use the term cesarean scar ectopic pregnancy because I want people to understand that this is not an okay pregnancy. You can say cesarean scar pregnancy and some people go like, oh, but it's a live IUP, right? So that's okay. It's not, and I'll show you why. Here's an example of a cesarean scar pregnancy. This is the bladder reflection, so this is where the cesarean hysterotomy is made. The gestational sac is sitting in that anterior myometrium. It is not in the uterine cavity. Here's someone who's had a cesarean, has a scar, and thankfully this pregnancy is sitting up in the uterine cavity where it's supposed to be. So it's quite easy to see the difference early on. The problem is, as the pregnancy advances and grows, it moves into the cavity, and this can be a much harder diagnosis to make. There are two signs that are described. One of them is the crossover sign, and one of them is the low implantation sign. This is the crossover, so you draw a line that basically splits your uterus from the cervix to the fundus. If more than 2/3 of the gestational sac is anterior to that line in the setting of a prior cesarean section, be really, really, really high anxiety. This is a cesarean scar implantation. The other way to use that line is if you take the midpoint of the line between the cervix and the fundus, and if the sac is low and you have a prior cesarean section, you really need to think to yourself, do I just have a low implantation or is it low because it's stuck in the scar? And here's another thing that happens with prior cesareans, you get adhesions. And Dolores Pretorius's group just published a paper on the far angle when you have retroflexion of the uterus. A pitfall that people make is they zoom into the gestational sac and they don't realize that the fundus is retroflexed and way down here. And if you do that and you see a live embryo, you can be fooled into thinking you have an okay IUP. But you don't. You have this bulge beyond the external contour of the uterus. A lot of adhesions associated with that, and this is part of what causes the problem with placenta accreta spectrum, which I will also show you a case of later. Another thing to look at is the residual myometrial thickness. Remember, we said you could have a low-lying gestational sac that is associated with poor outcome, but it's still an IUP. This is a person who has a low implantation, did not have a prior cesarean, and you can see nice thick myometrium there. These two are cesarean scar pregnancies. There's a little sliver of myometrium there, and it's imperceptible here. So look at your location. Look at whether it is low in the uterus, whether it is anteriorly placed in that low myometrium, and what your residual myometrial thickness is. Why do I obsess about this? Because these are the bad things that happen when we don't make this diagnosis. This was a case that happened about a year and a half ago in my own practice. We knew that this patient had had a prior cesarean delivery. She came in bleeding and cramping. She had a gestational sac with a dead embryo, sort of flat and irregular, moving into the top of the cervix. And this was called an abortion in progress, and she was sent home from the ER with some misoprostol. Returned catastrophic hemorrhage. For some reason, they did a D&C in the ER. I don't understand how. Realized that their implements had gone in too far, that they had perforated the uterus, rushed her to the operating room, ended up having to do a hysterectomy. This is the hole in the lower uterine segment at the site of the scar, and this was a C-section ectopic that was trying to miscarry, but couldn't because it was abnormally adherent up here, and so when someone stuck a curette in there, they went straight out the myometrium. So this is a person who had two living children, and you know the way it was couched, well, you were bleeding to death, we had no choice. But had we considered the diagnosis here, she could have had a more controlled approach procedure and maybe not lost her uterus. The other reason why it is important not to miss this diagnosis is that cesarean scar pregnancies grow up to be placenta accreta spectrum. And that is a scary diagnosis. This is an intraoperative picture. This is the hysterotomy. In my institution, they always do a fundal hysterotomy to deliver the baby. So they do that. Then they put the mum to sleep. There's a spinal to get the baby out. Then mum goes under GA and they proceed with the cesarean hysterectomy. This is the placenta bulging through that lower uterine segment with all these scary vessels. Some of that adhesive disease that I showed you earlier acts as a scaffold for abnormal blood vessels to crawl along, which means that these are very bloody surgeries. And these are the ones where you'll see on the local news that somebody, some hospital needed 50 units of blood for this pregnant lady that was bleeding. One of my good friends, who's MFM, who's one of the surgeons in our accreta program, came in one morning and he sat down and he goes, 50. And I looked, he goes, 50, Kennedy. And I happen to know that he's over 50, so it wasn't his birthday. And I was also over 50 at the time. And I said, you want to give me some context here? Units. He has a very brittle diabetic child. I'm thinking, but you give lots of little bits of. Long story short, he personally had used 50 units of blood that week and had gotten a you naughty boy call from the blood bank. Those were two planned cesarean hysterectomies in accreta patients at our center of excellence. That's how bad this disease is, and even in the best hands, catastrophic hemorrhage can occur, to the point that the MFM have now said, if you diagnose a cesarean scar pregnancy, that pregnancy should be terminated. It should not continue. So if you take nothing else home from this talk, think about cesarean scar pregnancies. These are some references that I can recommend to read. And being an obstetric imager, the first trimester and diagnosis of anomalies, there is so much more than just alive or dead. But in 20 minutes, obviously, I can't cover that. So the session is now ended in terms of lectures. We're happy to take questions. And I think we had at least one online question.
Question was, can you please clarify when to use a single FICO number versus an XX numbers? So the single number is for a single location, whether it's submucosal or subserosal. The X designation is for combination when there is a fibroid that involves both the submucosa and the subserosal. The second question is, what about a single small subcentimeter echogenic mass circumscribed in the ovary?
Thank you for the question. And your question is what the whole ARRS committee is questioning actively as we speak. So yes, you're right that this single small subcentimeter echogenic intraovarian focus, we would be inclined to think that it is either a teratoma, but when we think about all the cases that we have seen, corpus albicans too can have a similar echogenic well-circumscribed appearance. So there is a lot of overlap there, and we are looking at some IOTA 5 data to see how to incorporate this into the lexicon. It is not a part of the current lexicon, and I know that this is one of the loopholes in the current version of ORADS. But here's what I think about it. It will be addressed in the future. After all, LIRADS has more versions than I can count on my fingers and toes, so we will get this sorted in the next few versions. I have one more question here. How do we interpret endometrial thickness in non-bleeding postmenopausal women?
So the answer to that is that it really depends on the thickness of the endometrium, and the endometrium anything up to probably greater than 5 millimeters or so, we'd recommend MRI or hysteroscopy. Any other questions from the audience?
I think we have a slightly different approach to that at UCSF.
Hello. I think it's off. Well, excellent talk, everyone. I just want to have a question. For the ORADS MRI, if you have a solid enhancing component, but it said if it's dark T2, that should be considered ORADS 2. Am I correct? Or?
Yes, that is absolutely correct. And the way to work through T2 dark tissue is to look at the diffusion characteristics of this tissue. If it is T2 dark, diffusion dark, then the ORADS MRI technology, it's a dark, dark lesion. It's a fibrous lesion. And fibrous lesions, like fibrous tissue elsewhere, can have slow progressive enhancement, mostly likely delayed enhancement, and that is completely all right. So as long as it is diffusion dark, T2 dark, it is absolutely an ORADS 2, and that's where ORADS MRI, that's another scenario where ORADS MRI adds incremental value than just doing an ultrasound. Thank you.
I thought that the maximum endometrial size for a non-bleeding postmenopausal woman was 8 millimeters. That changed?
No,
I thought you said 5 millimeters for bleeding and no bleeding.
Yes, you're right. It is 5, yes.
It's 5 for both?
No, it's 8.
It's 8.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
So I think there is a little bit of, non-consensus there because we might have a slightly different practice. When I was trained, I too used a cutoff of 8, and I think there is a meta-analysis which has been published by Rebecca Spitz-Beinman, which now gives a cutoff of 11. However, in practice, I have seen the cutoff of 8 to 11 being used for non-bleeding postmenopausal women, but there is a meta-analysis that says we up to 11, we will be fine, but there's no consensus that I'm aware of on the threshold.
So the question is, in the case you showed from your facility of C-section scar ectopic, what would have been the follow-up if it was suggested initially? I don't think there would have been follow-up, but she wouldn't have been sent home from the emergency room with misoprostol. And the management of cesarean scar ectopic pregnancy is evolving. You know, I'm old enough. I tell my residents that I've been doing radiology since before they were born, and it's true. Back in the day, it used to be that cesarean scar ectopics were treated with injection of methotrexate and KCL. The idea being that if you operated on them, there would be catastrophic hemorrhage. But several meta-analyses came out following that, saying that actually, you inject them with methotrexate, sometimes the beta goes down, sometimes the beta goes up, sometimes there's a big hemorrhagic mass. And the move came that we should treat them surgically. In my own institution, they started out doing what they called a laparoscopic assisted DNC. So they would do a hysteroscope, try and pull out the trophoblastic material from the scar with someone looking through a laparoscope from the outside to make sure they didn't perforate the uterus. But they are now so comfortable doing it hysteroscopically that they don't routinely insert the laparoscope. So what would have happened in that patient if we had raised the fact that we thought this was an adherent C-scar pregnancy is she would have gone to the OR that night for a careful, controlled suction, no sharp instruments, just the hysteroscope and gentle suction to pull the tissue out. She may have perforated anyway, but she wouldn't have perforated in the ER in an uncontrolled environment. And I think that's all the questions we have online.
Sorry, one more question. Thank you all so much for the wonderful talks. So we are also not doing dynamic contrast enhancement for the O-RADS MRI, and we have a large patient population that already has the uterus removed. In those situations, is there anything that we can use to help guide us between an O-RADS 4 or an O-RADS 5 since we don't have the myometrium?
I'm sorry, I did not hear like a little portion of your question. Oh, I'm so sorry. Could you repeat it again?
Yeah, so we don't do dynamic contrast enhancement, and a large population, our population has their uterus already gone. So if we're deciding between like an ORADS 4 versus an ORADS 5 when we don't have the myometrium to compare to, is there any recommendations as to distinguish it between the two, or do you just kind of leave it as at least ORADS 4?
Yeah, so that is really a challenging situation that if you're not, or my question for you would be twofold. So first thing is that, are we doing dynamic acquisitions at all? Okay, so non-dynamic acquisition, what to do when the uterus is gone, that is really hard. And when that happens, I think we are at a loss because ORADS kind of doesn't apply anymore. And all we can say is that there is enhancing solid tissue, which increases the risk of malignancy. So it is hard to give an ORAD score because neither do we have the curves available to differentiate between 3, 4, and 5, or the non-dynamic assessment to differentiate between 4 and 5. There are no built-in mechanisms in ORADs per se, but I think based on what you've described, is that we could say that it's at least an ORAD score of 4 or 5, and an exact score may not be able to be given in that situation, unfortunately.
Okay, well, thank you all for coming, and everybody go get tea or coffee.